The number of swaps used to solve the cube is always even. These swaps can be in two different forms. One form is an even number of edge swaps and or an even number of corner swaps. But in blindfold solving, parity is referred to an odd number of edge swaps and an odd number of corner swaps. You should already know what parity is though. There are many different ways to fix parity depending on the execution method and execution order. I will show two ways of dealing with parity. First, I will show how to fix parity if you execute the corners first. So what you can do is solve all the corners except leave URB and ULB swapped. Now just solve the edges. When you're onto the last edge, you can set it up to a PLL and solve the two corners and edges simultaneously. So here is UF to RB. I'm going to set this up by doing L prime E L. That just turned it into an R perm. And undo. If you have parity and you get something like this, where the last target is BU, the setups can be complicated, so you might just want to learn the T-perm that flips the two edges. This one is X prime, R2, U prime, R prime, U, R prime, X, F prime, U prime, F, R, U, R prime, U prime. I will now demonstrate parity if you execute the edges first. If you do this, parity is so much easier to deal with, in my opinion. You don't need to remember whether you have parity. You find out during execution. So what you can do is solve all the edges normally, but with the last target, set it up and do a Z perm. So UF to FR, I'm going to set it up to there. Now I'm going to do a Z perm. Now the idea of that is I just swapped UL and UB and undo. Now I can solve the corners however I want. They're mostly solved now because it's easier to look at. But as long as you solve the corners and only swap UL and UB while doing so, you're not gonna mess up anything. Seeing as this makes parity easy, it's nice to execute this way during multi-blind. Here are some additional things relating to parity while executing the edges first. If the last edge target is UB or UL, U-perms can be used to fix parity. This, for example, where the last edge target is UB, can be fixed by cycling these three edges clockwise. So what that just did was swap UB and UL. The counterclockwise U-perm will do the same if the last target was UL. If the last target is BU, this algorithm can be used, which you should already know. So that just swapped UB and UL. If the last target is LU, its inverse can be used. Again, that swapped UB and UL. I did say I was going to explain R-move cancellations in U-perms. Here are just a couple of things to keep in mind before I start. You can only make these cancellations if the first target you set up goes to UL, and the cancellations I will demonstrate only work with the common 2-gen U-perm, this one. Once again, if you want to make these cancellations, the target you set up first needs to go to UL. In this example, the cycle is UF to UL to FR. When I cancel moves in a U-perm, I see it as three parts. The first part is identifying which U-perm will be used, hence finding what can be done to cancel the first turn. It is a clockwise U-perm. As you can see, the first turn of the clockwise U-perm is R2. So this target needs to be an R2 off from UR. So I'm going to do R prime. The second part is executing the rest of the U-perm except for the last turn. Here is the third and final part. Without finishing the last turn of the U-perm, you need to determine where the target is. The last turn of the clockwise U-perm is R prime, which means the target that originally was at FR is now here at BR. That means R2 will get it back to its spot. You may be thinking it's easier if you execute the last move of the U-perm and undo it from there. This is understandable because you shouldn't have to trace the piece at the end like I just did. In fact, you don't have to do that. So here's a simple rule to go by. If the first cancellation brings the target to DR, without executing the last turn of the U-perm, it's going to end up at BR. And vice versa. So if you set the target to BR, it's going to end up at DR. When I say it's going to end up, I mean the position the target is in without executing the final turn of the U-perm. Here is the last example of cancellations. UF to FR to FL. Now, this time there isn't a target already set up at UL, so FL will have to go there. L prime. Again, you can break this into three parts. For the first part, this U-perm will be counterclockwise, as you can see. The counterclockwise U-perm starts with R, so I'm going to do R2. As for the second part, I will execute the rest of the U-perm. Remember to leave the last turn though. Here's the last part. I said if the first move sets the target to BR, it's going to end up at DR. So without tracing the last move of this U-perm, I know the target is now here at DR. To bring it back to FR, I will do R. Now L to undo the first setup move. In regular TuRBo, the targets always get set up on each side of the buffer. You can save a lot of time if you don't always do that. It's possible to use TuRBo to solve any case as long as the cycling pieces are on the same layer. Example, UF to DL to UB. Using normal TuRBo, this could be solved like this. L2, B prime, R prime. Now the algorithm, and undo. However, there is a one move setup to a U-perm. Now it's UF to UL to UB. And undo. Things can get a bit complicated when you get something like this. UF to RF to UB. R will bring these pieces into the same layer. Now the cycle is UF to RU to UB. The complication I'm pointing out is the target in the middle of the cycle, this one. The reason why it has made things more complicated is because it's flipped. When the target in the middle of the cycle is flipped like this, you need to look at the cycle differently. Well, you might not need to, but this is how I do it anyway. I'm going to imagine these three edges flipped. Now the cycle is FU to UR to BU. With a rotation, it's easy to see that TuRBo can solve this case. UF to RU to LU. And undo. As I said, you can use TuRBo whenever the cycling pieces are on the same layer. It doesn't have to be the U layer. For example, UF to LF to DF. This can be solved by just a counterclockwise U-perm by first rotating. With a lot of this, I may have not explained very well, and I'm sorry for that, but there is a point where you need to sit down with the cube and figure stuff out on your own. I probably included things that weren't necessary, but I just threw in whatever I thought was relevant. So that's it. My finger tricks are crap, yours should be better than mine. I hope this tutorial wasn't a waste of your time and was helpful. Thanks for watching.